Welcome back to IGN's Summer of Gaming. The festivities continue tomorrow, but right now, we'd like to let the good times roll. Freedom Games is a publisher founded in 2020 that was built on the very notion of partnership, supporting independent developers and helping them get their games made. In partnership with Freedom Games, IGN is proud to present a showcase of all the upcoming games they've got in the works. Enjoy.
It was always a dream to, well, make a video game. I guess everyone wants to do that.
You really want to make fictional worlds. You really want to make your own universe.
So we decided to leave everything.
What started off as kind of a passion project turned into having a small staff and full funding.
There's a lot of firsts here in this project.
We knew it was like kind of way more than we could handle, but if we just work hard and put our minds to it and make the game we want to make, we think we can be super successful.
Good Heavens is a cozy open-world sandbox crafting game with procedural map generation and storytelling. The player's goal is to improve their base and character while exploring a rich world with different biomes, races, cultures, and cities. We offer a unique dynamic class system for co-op multiplayer, enabling various playstyles. It's possible to play a game as a fighter, farmer, cook, miner, trader, or even as a card player. Each player in multiplayer can play individually within the team. Some of them are exploring, slaying monsters, and doing quests from the cities. Others are building the base, farming and taming animals. Traders are building roads and trying to find unique resources from other cities. The team events gather the team together. Slaying a boss or organizing a beer festival can be team events. The world of Good Heavens is created procedurally. Moreover, the races, the cities, and their cultures, also the history of the city with its neighbors and their behaviors, are procedural as well. Players might come across wild combinations. A town of nudist elves are radical and aggressive as part of their behavior, so they're attacking anyone who enters their town with their clothes on. Another random combination could be BDSM-loving vampires or hippie werewolves. It's a comedy game, and we do everything with that in mind. Once we create the world with its towns, cultures, and history, the world will start interacting with itself. The cities will start evolving according to their cultures and their respective technology path. They trade with other cities and harness resources from their environment. If the player gives them the tech, they will continue their evolution. They will make new buildings. With those buildings, they will make new weapons, and eventually they will attack their rival city and destroy it. A single action by the player can lead to enormous outcomes. If you're watching this, then it means we want you on board as well. So jump in. What are you waiting for?
I would say that it's an endless comedy engine that you can play forever. You can play Good Heavens in a casual way or in a hardcore way. It's up to you. The game has a massive scale map. We have different biomes and we have different resources and animals and monsters on each of these biomes. And we have also this NPC and cities layer on top of this. So you can build your own base. You trade between those besties and you try to find the balance in this world in the end. And every time you restart the game, there is a new challenge waiting for you. Some of them start as a more developed city and they go into a small town and then they become a larger town and then they become a city and then at the end they became metropoles. But in order to arrive into that late stage, they need to find all the resources that specific culture is requiring to evolve. You're trying to find out what's going on. You get quests from them, and then for yourself, you try to improve your base, improve your character. So you kill some monsters, you hunt for some animals, and you craft some things for your base and yourself. And every time you restart the game, you find that these races and cultures are different from the previous game. And there's some kind of a new story in between them. That's the procedural part of the game. These cities will have different ambitions. They will have different relationships with each other. And you will find different quests in each time you restart the game. it enables you to tell different stories every time you restart the game. I mean, we don't want a linear game that is the same every time you play. I mean, the magic of procedural generation is to give you a different challenge every time. So you're building your character, and you might try to build a farmer character, for example, or a warrior character, or a trader character. Starting with the biomes, each of these biomes can hold different races, and each of these races can have different cultures. Depending on those cultures, they have different buildings and classes in those cities. So those guys you can trade with, take quests from, and just go into some dialogues with them and try to find out about the rest of the world. So depending on how you start the game, a single player or three player or seven player, the difficulty of the game will change. Our procedural generation works quite well. I was afraid that it wouldn't be this easy to handle a huge map like this. It would create some problems. The second thing is the combat system we are developing right now is somehow better than many of these current multiplayer crafting games, I would say. It's been around a year since we started working on the early concepts and research about procedural generation. It took us some time to overcome some of these technical challenges. We're not the first overcoming those, but it took some time nonetheless.
Legends tell of a golden time in years past of great clashes, heroes, and triumphs.
Hey everybody, Phil, lead designer for Symphony of War, the Nephilim Saga. 6 years ago, we set out to create a brand new strategy RPG series, and today we're finally ready to announce the first title's official launch date. And that launch date is right now, today. Please go check it out at the Steam store. RPG fans, we think you're gonna love this one. I want to send out a special thank you to everyone who's followed and supported our development along the way, and to everyone who gives it a try. We hope you enjoy playing it as much as we enjoy creating it. My name is Phil, and I am the co-founder of Dancing Dragon Games. Symphony of War, the Nephilim Saga, is the first in a strategy game series that we are developing.
It is a political war drama. Your protagonist is an Imperial Army officer. Some shocking events happen. You get framed for murder. You have to clear your name. There's so many twists and turns, and you're saving the world, as you do in these games. I love to tinker. I love to experiment. I want to be able to set this up and then auto battle. I want to have a little bit more automation. And Symphony of War delivers that exactly. It's turn-based, and the bulk of your micromanagement is done before you go into a mission or a chapter in a home-based sequence. And I love that. In the home-based phase, you will be able to buy stuff, and that's, you know, hire conscripts or mercenaries. You can buy artifacts at the shop. You'll be able to tech up. You can go into the support conversations and, you know, have the characters interact with each other, react to the events of the world. You can do friendships, bonds, which is love and romance, and family. Tactical phase is the other half. Your squads that you've built are plopped down into a map. Boom, that's my army. That's my setup. It's beautiful. Mission go. So we've got open terrain, which includes your plains, your roads, grasslands, stuff like that. And you've got your rough terrain, with your woods, your swamp, your townscapes. You have your squads, and you've painstakingly made their formation, chosen their class, chosen their leader, their traits, their artifacts, and you send them in, and you go, and then you sit back and watch. The enemy is pretty clever in this game, I gotta say. Hats off to my programmer for that. So, I love the classes. There's heavy infantry, heavy cavalry, light infantry, archery, firearms, magicians, support, and dragons. You start at tier 1, and then the ultimate is your tier 4. You start as a piddly little guy with leather armor, and then you upgrade to a guy that's a little bit cooler, now he has full plate armor, and then you upgrade again to a guy that's really decked out in awesome, like, gilded armor. Out of 50 classes, I think we've done a really good job of getting a really big wealth of pixel art that we can use, and it's beautiful and very well animated. Yeah, class system looks freaking good. There's things that will shock you, and there are things that will surprise you, and things that will delight you, and things that will crush you. It's just very visceral. The world setting and the characters and the history, it's all years and years in the making. I want this game to really convey that it is an expression of myself. I know how magical that feels to kind of be whisked away into a fantasy world. Trust me, it's awesome.
There was a time when we forgot who we are. We were ungrounded and destroyed our world in the name of greed. But now, we remember. We remember that we are not in control of nature, but we are part of it. The world is our healer. And we are grateful. We are grounded by the air we breathe and seek balance with nature. We are not separate from the universe. We are an awareness of ourselves. Every grain of sand, every forgotten star in the night sky, and every ray of life-giving energy is part of us. You are here to survive. And you are here to find this wisdom. There is a stillness waiting for you. Go and find it. Retreat to NN.
My name is Justin Hosford. I'm the founder of Head West Studio, and we're making a game called Retreat to Ennin. Retreat to Ennin is first and foremost a survival game with a more relaxing angle to it and a little bit of mindfulness mixed in. I was trying to make a Zen kind of experience, and I'd never seen that in a video game before as a core mechanic. Your abilities in the game are attached to your spirit level. If your spirit level drains, your health starts to drain, and you lose the ability to do things like light a fire, craft items, sprint, hold your breath underwater for very long. So you need to keep your spirit level up in order to be more effective at survival. And the way that you keep your spirit level raised is through meditation. Meditation's had a profound effect in my life. It seems like something that maybe the world could use even more of now. And if this little game can help even one person achieve that, I think that it's reached its goal.
Gently close your eyes and take in a nice, deep breath.
For years, I was a film and television composer. Because of that, I was able to focus a lot of energy on the score to this game, and I didn't want to just do the obvious chill Zen music. You know, I wanted to make something emotional, even sad at times. I tried to make it, I guess, as connecting and beautiful as I possibly could. To connect people to nature, what we've done is made a very lush, full, rich environment. It's not procedurally generated, so every path you take, every valley you walk into, every corner you turn, I tried to make it have its own personality. On the main island of Enin, the tropical island, there's going to be creeks, ponds, surrounded by a huge ocean. And when you go into the redwoods, that's a much, much larger area. If a player is going to get lost, that's where that's going to happen. The majesty of seeing an elk or a wolf roaming around the Arctic level just looks really cool. All in all, I think that they're very immersive environments. I kind of want this to be a game where people get lost sometimes. There isn't a map or a compass. All you have is a home icon on the last place that you slept. The player's going to kind of have to watch where they're going and just keep an eye on where things are. You got to get out there. You have to explore. There's a variety of animals to hunt on all three biomes, like deer and elk. There are wolves in the game, and we have gillnet fishing. Basically, everything is gathered. You don't cut down trees in this game. You can collect the wood off the ground, the scrap wood and driftwood, and turn that into a beautiful wooden structure with the technology. There is no wasted item in the collection system. Everything has a purpose. It's a hope and a dream that maybe someday the technology that we're developing can actually help us live closer to nature and not continue removing us further from it. So it goes from kind of elementary, basic survival, all the way up to building this huge dream retreat. Even when the player gets done with the story of the game, they have the option, if they want to at any time, to return to this huge base that they've built and continue meditating and just have this place they can go to relax anytime they want. Begin meditation. I want this to be a game where people just escape to their second home away from home and just be in this peaceful environment that they use their creativity to build. And they're a part of the environment and not destroying it.
If you find this tape, I beg you, listen to it carefully. My name is Elise. I recently settled in the village of St. Exel, a quiet and isolated place near the sea. But during the annual fair, something happened. Armed troops attacked the village and tried to kidnap us all. I barely escaped, only to wake up completely alone. Stuck inside this place that doesn't feel like home anymore. I am starting to lose all sense of reality. While I was investigating the village, I discovered a deeply rooted sickness. When I started to sink into its abyss,
St. Exel Church,
I was finally able to see more clearly. Because even if this place is constantly challenging me, it also keeps pushing me to question everything. If, by chance, anybody is listening, please come help me. I'm not going to last much longer. It's now or never.
Hello, I'm Mel Vigneault, the studio director of Elsewhere Experience, the studio behind Broken Pieces. I am also the sound designer and audio director for the game. Broken Pieces is a game that's set in a coastal village in France. It's an adventure game where you play a character named Elise. There's like some kind of paranormal phenomena that are happening inside the village and she cannot escape. Our goal for the game was to really catch the attention of the player, and to do so we had to do something inside a world that's feeling very real, something that's tangible. You try and make the player believe in something and then you switch their perspective. If everything is very realistic, then when you have things that are paranormal, they meet in the cross point with the realism, the player would question at first and then integrate inside its perspective of the world. What we really wanted the player to feel is the anxiety and loneliness that the main character Elise is feeling. Loneliness, it's a difficult sensation to communicate. There's actually only one character inside the game. You don't talk with anybody, you don't interact with other people. You don't have music. When you want to play music, you actually have to use the tape player inside the game. And I think that's what life is about too. Sometimes you listen to music because you want to break this loneliness. Because there's so many moments where you don't have music. You have to have this constant soundscape of what's surrounding you. We did a lot of recording where we live and we really wanted it to be very present. All the environment were done by my associate Benoit. He drew most of his references from the region we live in and from the places we see every day. All the architecture surrounding us that are not seen a lot inside the video game industry. We are a very huge fan of puzzle games, of course, and puzzles are very, very interesting because they give you the opportunity to insert story inside it. They give you the opportunity to talk about things that interest you, and they give you the opportunity to use the world fully and the exploration and the space you are in. The game is pretty unique, you know, the features there's inside it, the way we made things, it's very ours. We didn't compromise on that. Thanks a lot for checking out Broken Pieces with us, et on espère que vous serez au rendez-vous. Merci.
Hi everybody and welcome aboard. I'm Stefano, co-owner of Stellex Software, and this is our project, a minimalistic narrative game called Monorail Stories in a modern day pixel art setting. So what's the game about? Well, the game will star two different protagonists, Sylvie and Amal, who live in different cities and travel each day on the same monorail, but they never meet because they travel at different times and opposite directions. Along the way they will meet different people and make different choices, but they don't know they are sharing a common story, because what one character does on his route has consequences on the route of the other car. So every choice the player makes will have repercussions, every choice will bring the player to a different story and to a completely different ending. But what does this game have to offer? Well, so first, the game has a story mode with branching storylines and multiple endings, but we also want to offer something new and not common in this kind of games. So we decided to add an innovative asynchronous multiplayer mode, where what one player does on his turn will impact how the story plays out for the other player. And last but not least, we also want to offer a kind of endless story mode with new contents added regularly. Okay, that was it. Thank you for traveling with us, and I hope you enjoyed this short first ride on the monorail.
I'm Stefano, welcome aboard. I'm co-owner of Stellex Software, very, very small husband and wife game studio. My wife, she's an artistic director for the game, and this is our project, a minimalistic narrative video game called Monorail Stories in a modern day pixel art setting. So the game will start to different protagonists, Sylvie and Amal, who live in different cities and travel each day on the same monorail, but they never meet because they travel at different times and opposite direction. So along the way they will meet different people, they will make different choices, but they don't know they are sharing a common story, because what one character does on his route has consequences on the route of the other character.
So basically every choice the player makes will have repercussions, and every choice will bring the player to a different story, to a completely different ending. We have around 10 different endings in the game. The funny thing is that each ending is so different one from the other, we're really surprised at the players. It was a huge challenge for us because we tried different ways to manage all these different paths that the player has. And what we find out really to focus everything on the relationships with the other commuters on the train. One of the stories is really about ordinary people in extraordinary everyday stories about commuting, human relations and destiny waiting to be discovered. In a world where everybody's screaming so loud, we love to whisper. So we really want to give this kind of experience to players. The game not only can be played, of course, in single player, but we added this innovative asynchronous multiplayer mode for two players. Well, in the multiplayer mode, two different players take turns controlling the two main characters. It's cooperative, so we share the same experience, but the choices made by one player during his turn will impact how the story plays out for the other player. Be able to play with a friend of yours or with a complete stranger and share the journey together, knowing that your choices will impact somebody else's game. That's what the game is about. This multiplayer mode, you can play it online or you can play it on Twitch. The streamer plays as one of the two main characters and one of the viewers can join the game and play as the second character. So really be able to participate together, so play together with the stream. We spend a lot of time working with this plugin because we really believe that adding the multiplayer mode to narrative games will really bring something new and fresh and exciting to the experience. It's really a minimalistic game. You have simply, the characters can only move left and right. They have a button to interact with everything. So it's very, very easy to play. It's really a game to enjoy. Our idea really came up from our daily commuting and trying to imagine what's the story behind all the passengers, all the other commuters. If I start talking with somebody of them, will my life change? Will their life change too? And so it's really a game for pondering life that explore intense and touching stories. Simply enjoy.
My name is Reese. I'm the creator of Boundless Games. We're currently working on Monster Tribe, which is an open world RPG. It's a monster catcher game in kind of like a futuristic native tribe type of setting. What sets this game apart is we decided to go for more of a team-based battling combat. And so you actually use your entire team throughout all battles. And you have a lot of exploration elements that I find maybe aren't explored in most games. Through exploring the environment, you're gonna come across a lot of secrets, whether that being treasure or resources or materials that you can use. There's four types of gathering you can do. There's harvesting, fishing, wood cutting, and mining. This system helps to give a sense of collection and accomplishment, and almost adding a grinding element to our game. This is our downtime, our off time, to offset the balance between battle after battle. What makes this game open world and, you know, non-linear is you can tackle any of the areas in the game at any point that you want to, and you can take them on in any order you'd like. Collecting monsters isn't the traditional throwing some kind of orb or object at it. And so in our game, instead, what we've done is we've created a system where monsters drop DNA as a battle reward. You can then take it to the DNA stations, and you can use these to actually revive and resurrect these creatures to then, you know, have them on your team. Monster mutations is a mechanic in the game where you can mutate them using resources and items. And so originally it started off as just a way for us to get more variety in monster encounters that opened up to about 300 different combinations of creatures. And so we just kind of thought, like, why not throw that into the player's hands? It changes their element, their class, and also their design. Once we actually get into the battle encounters, it is a team-based battling system. So you'll have four slots for your monsters. And so you can have a 4v4 battle. And this takes place on a 3x2 style grid. You can have moves that hit all squares on the battlefield, or just the front line, or the two middle squares, dodging moves and kind of predicting what your opponent has in their arsenal to strategize through more than just using the right moves on the right guys. You also have to worry about your position, the enemy's position in this group-based, turn-based combat. We've been working on this game for over 2 years now. I'm just proud of the entire process of making it and becoming a better developer because of this game.
My name is Enrique. I'm a solo dev for Neon Blight, which is a small cyberpunk game that I've been creating for the past 4 years. It's been a huge passion project that I've built since I was 17. I describe Neon Blight as somewhat Metroidvania and roguelites. I use the term Metroidvania loosely because it's not a platformer, but it has those kind of elements of an open world map where you explore different areas. That is definitely a bullet hell, especially with the bosses and some of their attacks. You go into a room and then you shoot everything you see without worrying about anything. So it's an open world game where you kill bosses and you go back to your shop and sell guns, items, and anything that you collect in what I call the outer border, which is the big open world combat area. If you survive, you can go back to town and sell your weapons. So the story, basically, she's an ex-cop and she becomes a gun shop owner as her retirement, and she's dragged into this bigger than herself story of trying to collect the ultimate weapon before, you know, something bad happens. It's a story that teases a lot of stuff. It makes the player question what kind of world they're in. I think it'll lay the grounds for further expansions of the world. There's the main hub called Eden, which is a small town that your player lives in and has her gun shop in. The Neon Stop, which is where you buy all of your items to put in your shop, couches, display units, anything like that. It's a town where you can interact with NPCs and stuff like that. And then there's the Outer Border, which is the combat area. It has 7 different biomes in it. An abandoned forest, the Lone North, I call, which is like a snowy biome, a bunker. You explore different shops, talk to some people. I'd say the combat feels pretty solid. It's fast-paced, it can get hectic. There's a few different mobs. There's one called the Demon Gangers, which is basically your generic pistol, shotgun, auto, rifle kind of group. And then there's the Blight mobs, which is, there's a runner that just runs after you. There's one that kind of has a spore, I would say, kind of ability, where it's just his head bursts. And then there's bullets that fly everywhere. There's robots also. Quite a bit of variety. I'd say Neon Blight wouldn't be the same without the music. Our composer is incredible, and every time they put something out, I'm like blown away every time. On a personal level, it's very much a labor of love, and for the genre of roguelites, the genre of Metroidvania together, and I think that people that like cyberpunk games will find some nice things in my game, especially in the art style and the world that I built, and that my composer has pushed forward with the audio and the music.
Hello, welcome one and all. Prepare your limbs, contestants. It's game day. That's just nasty. Today we're watching a race to the finish. Whether that be the finish line or the grave, who knows? Some have spoken out on social media to say that this section has been designed simply far too hard and it's cruel.
I first started getting into games probably about 7 or 8 years old, tinkering around with game engines. I started putting games on the web, flash games and things like that. I always liked the idea of really silly deaths, characters getting blown to bits in like a cartoony way. It's usually an area of frustration, but when you can see your character's head just flying off and blood's going everywhere, it's like, you just got nothing but humor there.
You're gonna feel bad in the morning.
I come up with the idea of having like a Ninja Warrior / Total Wipeout death competition. I was actually working 2 jobs at the same time as developing the game. I'd have all these fantastic ideas while I was there. You know, I'd be on the checkout just thinking about Slaughter League, and by the time I get home, I'd just like, We ended up deciding that it'd be best if I work full-time on the game. This game, it sounds corny, but it's changed my life in that way. Whereas no other game had before. It's just flipped my life to where I want it to be. So to finally be able to do this as a job is just insane. I love it.
Thank you. I've always thought that I would be good at making video games. My mom just sent me a picture of a drawing I did when I was like 8, titled My Own Game. I was diagnosed with Asperger's autism as a child, and I basically kind of just told myself, there's no way I could be in management. But through therapy as a child and then continuing my own efforts, I overcame it. Now I'm doing my dream, doing something I thought I couldn't do. Through this process, I've really learned how valuable people are. There's 20 people on the team. I'm just one of them. And I'm hoping to convey some of that through the game's narrative. You have to have growth and you have to have progress. So for us, with One Lonely Outpost, loneliness helps highlight the value of connection.
I'm Yoz, the lead game designer of Humanity Z. It's an open world zombie survival game that you can play on your own or even better with friends. We're only actually a team of 3. Well, we're nearly 2 years into development of like the actual game. Humanity Z's just sort of formed like naturally, nothing to what it is like right now, which is we're pretty proud of, to be honest. Let's think realism and then can we make it fun? The open world is one of the main things because the map is pretty darn huge. I think we're up to 8 by 8 kilometers, so people are going to get lost. You can literally go anywhere you want. You can find spray cans and then you can like track where you are, and it's that way of like mapping out where you've been. So there'll be obviously zombies, there's no getting away from them, but there will be other non-player character AI, like bandits, gangs, some friendly, some not. We have like random item spawners that are created for each building. Say me and you were looting like a town nearby. Sometimes you might not get anything, sometimes you might get a little bit. You could go to those locations and hope no one's looted them before you, or it's your lucky day and that loot is there for you to gather. We decided to do multiplayer from the get-go. You can play alone and, you know, be the survival guy. Playing with friends is definitely a how the game is made to be played. That's what we want it to be as well. And we just felt like it'd be so much more fun so you could like have a community of say three different of your sort of buddies, and you could sort of go different paths to sort of cater for the whole community. Then one be a builder, one be a combat guy, one be like a farmer, that kind of thing. So yeah, you could kind of mix it up and get the best for like a community. You can kind of like invest in the character, so you can kind of level him up, develop skills, gear it towards a play style. But if you die, you lose everything. To learn your lessons from the last time and don't make them same mistakes again. That was one thing we wanted, is that build anywhere. If it was an apocalypse, you had your own house, you would use what you could to fortify the house that you currently live in. I don't know, the fortification is just one of my favorite parts of the game at the minute. That was one of the things that we first started on, was we literally began with fortification, and then we expanded to there from like, okay, what if someone wants to live in the woods and just be like a hunter? So then we've gone for your traditional logs, build walls, build fences, basically give the player like freedom to kind of build wherever they wanted, build in a supermarket where there might be some decent food and like maybe like higher ground. That's what we wanted to do. It's literally freedom of the player, that's like story writing. They can kind of play their own way. Say that I'm proud of like what we've done as a team, really. First game that all three of us have ever done, a hardcore survival game that is fun to play. And you know, we hope that our passion for these games shows in our game, and people just enjoy surviving in our world.
Calamel is in its twilight. The sands have buried its kingdoms. Corruption unburies its subjects.
I am Michael Shistick. I'm the art director for Sands of Aura. Sands of Aura is an action RPG in like a post-apocalypse fantasy setting. You're getting on your sand ship, you're cruising across this desolate wasteland of sand that was caused by this spell plague from ancient times, and the player is gonna unravel and figure out why that happened and maybe what they can do about it. But it definitely emphasizes on action RPG being the difficult, kind of brutal, learn to play it kind of way. You definitely will die a lot. I love a good boss encounter. I love overcoming a difficult situation. And it, for a lot of people, can be very frustrating, but the accomplished feeling that you get from overcoming these challenges, we think is the most rewarding thing you can have as a player. These bosses are like the climaxes of those areas, of those levels. So when you get there, we want them to be these cool, amazing, difficult, and almost cinematic encounters.
Well done.
the combat is not as instantaneous as a traditional action RPG. There's a bit of weight to the character's swings and actions, so you do have to be deliberate in what you decide to do in combat. Learning how to do that dance with them. You got the dodge timing and you got the swing in, you got another, like the whip attack, you paired it at the right timing. Like, it feels amazing when you're getting that dance down. The deaths will become less punishing and they'll come less often as you grow in experience as a player. And we really hope that the people have the willpower to get over that point. We talked about the grind and how difficult the game can be and how challenging these bosses are. And the boat is almost the opposite of that. It's the breath of fresh air of like, okay, I can kind of reassess myself. I can think about what I want to do. You can ride on those sand dunes and you can gain speed if you go down the waves and hop off them. And you see the whole horizon in front of you of all these different features. And we wanted the design to be that whatever feature you see out in the distance, there's something there to go and explore. The simplest terms I could qualify how our art style looks is grim, dark, light. I think when you go completely grim, dark, it's just kind of oppressive and overpowering. So we decided to have this mix. There's a lot of gray tones, there's a lot of like beiges and browns, but you'll get these interspersed scenes on the islands themselves that are brilliant with color and foliage and flowers. And all the different things that you can see in the game, like everything has a meaning, a reason, a story, a purpose. Every dead end has a reward. If it's loot or armor or reward, whatever it is, or an NPC or a character, like there should be always be something in every nook and cranny. And that's made the level design way more interesting and worth exploring. We want you to play with the different builds. I've always loved in MMOs and different action RPGs when you get to build the character you want to play. That actually mixes up the gameplay. That actually makes you think about what you're doing in combat. We want you to have that customization. So we needed to make sure that the armor and weapons and everything that you find to create and craft and customize your character is as unique and interesting as possible. The more inputs you have, the more infinite in range of combinations you can make. So there's things like the rune system. The rune system lets you build specific stats into your gear that you want. Like, let's say you want to be more armored, you get put in more armor runes. You want to be faster, you do haste runes. But on top of those, there's Spellblade, which is an elemental enchantment that you can add. Then you have like fire, ice, and lightning that can vary the combat in different ways. And then on top of that, there's also armor sets that have very unique set effects that make the gameplay very different in how you approach combat. And then the weapons, there's weapon heads that have an effect. There's the weapon handles that affect the animation and have effects. And then finally, there's pommels that all have like a poisoning effect, or like when you hit an enemy, there's projectiles that spawn. Being able to build the character you want to play, that was what we wanted to do. Going forward, there's going to be these big patches and there's going to be a lot that you can check out and that's worth playing. I think we have an incredible team of artists and programmers. I'm proud of our team, I'm proud of our game, and I hope everybody enjoys it.
for me, playing games is like building memories.
We're pouring our passion into this game, and it motivates me.
Making the game, it just feels like this surreal experience.
I come from a background that has nothing to do with video game development, and now it's my entire life and my new career.